Hello and welcome to another GCN Tech Geek Edition video. A few months back over on GCN, we released our cheap bike versus superbike video, and it stirred up a whole load of debate. And having read the comments, we felt that we definitely needed to revisit the subject, but at a different price point. So we have done that, and we've picked a real milestone, £1,000, €1,000, $1,000. It's a super competitive price point for bike brands. And therefore, if you buy one, you get a whole load of bike for your money. Now, to find out exactly how much bike you get, you should go and watch the full video over on GCN. But right here, right now, I thought we would take a closer look at our two bikes to actually really try and ascertain just what differences there are and why that translates out on the road. Firstly though, let's deal with what is the same, starting with the groupsets. I mean, of course, not literally, the groupsets are vastly different. We've got Shimano dura-ace and Shimano 105, and there are many, many reasons why they are different. But I would like to draw your attention to one key similarity, and that is shifting performance, or more specifically actually, the array and location of the shifting ramps and pins that you find on the cassette and on the chain rings. If you look closely, you will see that they are almost identical in appearance, meaning that theoretically, you should expect similar levels of shifting performance and drivetrain efficiency between the two group sets. And now, of course, on the superbike, we have electronic DI2, meaning that actually, the shifting performance is on another level. But were that to have mechanical, the difference between the two would be much, much smaller. Now, I put that to Shimano, and this is what they had to say. The goal is not to differentiate dura-ace and 105 on function. Instead, we differentiate them on materials and manufacturing methods used. Now, this leads to performance differences between the group sets, but it's not the aim, it's more of an outcome. As much as possible, comparing like for like, the aim is to manufacture 105 components with the same features and functionality as the top tier dura-ace components. So, there we go then. What would make a difference out on the road between these two group sets? I think probably just the weight, actually. Pure and simple. Now, what other similarities are there between the two bikes? Well, I think the position of the rider on the bike. Now, bear with me, because clearly, when you take these bikes out of the box, they are very, very different. But there is always that very simple element of adjustment. You can almost guarantee that you'll be able to get your saddle in exactly the right position. And so therefore, when you are buying a bike and you go to look at the geometry charts online, the key things to look at are the stack and the reach measurements. Now, when you compare these two bikes, you can see that our mid-range Endurace is 12 millimeters shorter, which is not a great deal, but it is 31 millimeters higher, which is pretty significant. And I will admit that with Matt's super slam position on his Aeroad, it would actually be nigh impossible to exactly replicate the position. The length is not a problem, simply swap out that 10 centimeter stem for an 11 or a 12 and you've got the reach totally sorted. But even with a negative 17 stem on there, which is pretty extreme, that's a minus 6 at the minute, you'd probably only be looking at losing about another 15 millimeters, leaving you 15 millimeters too high on this bike. However, that is Matt's position, and it's not mine. On my own Aeroad, I've got 2 centimeters of spacers underneath the stem, meaning that I could literally exactly replicate my position from my superbike over onto that Endurace. And that's pretty significant, because all the chat about bikes left to one side, fundamentally, the rider is the engine. And so if your position is correct, you'll be able to get the same power out. And actually, in terms of aerodynamics, you are also the biggest cause of drag. And so as long as your position is the same, you get the same aerodynamic performance too. So what about the differences then? Well, each and every component on our superbike is likely to be lighter than on our mid-range bike. And unfortunately, when you add that all together, that is quite a big difference. And it also makes it quite a tricky problem when you try and upgrade a mid-range bike, because to actually save any significant weight would mean changing a number of different components. And it's a dilemma, and it's not a cheap one. But the good news though, is that actually the overall weight difference is not all that significant, certainly not when you compare it to body mass, for example. So our superbike is about 7.3 kilos, and our mid-range bike is just over a kilo more. So what happens out on the road then? Well, not all that much, it has to be said. I mean, they definitely feel different. Lighter bikes respond differently, and that's often attributed to the fact they've got lighter wheels, and therefore they have lower rotating weight. But it's interesting, if you actually look into that, you'll find it's something of a myth. You actually couldn't measure the difference between heavy wheels and light wheels out on the road. And even if you did the theoretical calculations, you'd see that it's literally just fractions of a second that separates the two in a like-for-like standing start acceleration. I'd put money on the fact, though, that you could feel that difference in a blind test. Perhaps one for another day. Now, of course, it's when you start to climb, though, that weight really becomes a factor. And if you play around with an online calculator like bikecalculator.com, you can actually predict just what effect changing weight will have. So in this case here, this bike would be about 30 seconds faster up Alpe d'Huez at Tour de France speeds, so 6 watts per kilo. And that would extrapolate out to a minute if your power to weight at threshold was 3 watts per kilo. And that, remember, is for just over a 1 kilogram difference. Now, inevitably, what these figures mean to you will depend very much on your perspective. Certainly, I would guess it's unlikely to actually matter in the grand scheme of things, but just like with inertia and the rolling weight, actually, I would suggest that you would be able to feel the difference even if blindfolded. And does feel matter? Well, yeah, it does to me, but it's certainly not everything. A lighter bike does not necessarily make it more fun. Not by a long shot, in fact. Then we have aerodynamics. Now, this is a bit of a funny one, given that actually buying a superbike doesn't necessarily make it more aerodynamic, but we have made sure that we've chosen one that is, because ultimately, if you want to go faster, it is of paramount importance. So what then is the difference between these two? Well, it's actually a subject deserving of a video in its own right, probably. In fact, maybe even an entire series. But if we try and drill down, in essence, you've got drag that can be separated into two things. You've got air pressure drag and direct friction. So the former is when an object causes air to part from the surface of it as it moves through it. Now that creates a high pressure zone in front of the object, and importantly, a low pressure area behind the object, which is literally dragging it backwards. There is likely to be no significant difference between these two bikes with that latter friction drag. But what about pressure drag then? Well, if we look at the two bikes head on, we see some pretty subtle, but nevertheless significant differences in the surface area of these two bikes. I mean, for a start, the Aerode has much narrower profile head tube, and actually so narrow that it requires special narrow profile bearings made by Acros. It's also got a much narrower handlebar on there, stem, and also forks as well, all of which reduce that high pressure buildup in front of the object. And then, as we turn to look more towards the side and the back of the bike, we'll see some even more significant differences. Starting with the handlebars, a round tube has been replaced by that much lower profile, smoother shape. And the difference is even more significant when you look at the frame tubes. So a kind of squared off profile on the mid-range bike has been replaced by what's called a camtail design on our Aerode. And so that mimics the aerodynamic properties of a teardrop, which is like the most aero shape there is, but you chop off the tail, which is heavy and also really quite complicated to make. But you still get the same properties, and actually the aerodynamics improves even when you get round to more of a crosswind. Now, designing an aerodynamic frame set is an incredibly time-consuming process. In excess of 10,000 frame designs will be modeled and then tested using computational fluid dynamics before the final few are probably printed out and tested in a wind tunnel. Now, that is expensive, but then so too is the manufacturing process, whereby you take your aerodynamic prototype and then turn it into a suitably light and stiff and comfortable frame set worthy of superbike status. And it's also worth mentioning here that it would be almost impossible to mimic these frame shapes using aluminium or steel. And so that too adds considerably to the price tag, because you have to make it out of carbon fiber. Now, there are things you can do, of course, to improve the aerodynamics of your mid-range bike. Swapping out an aero front wheel and back wheel, of course, but that will have less of an effect, will reduce your drag. And then actually swapping out your handlebars and stem for this one would supposedly save you 5.5 watts at 45k an hour. And then even just tidying up your braking gear cables at the front end will also save you, well, probably fractions of a watt. Now, this bike will never be as aerodynamic as this one, but you can close that gap. However, just like when we're talking about weight before you, it's gonna cost you because you have to do it piece by piece. Hopefully that has given you a little bit more insight into the science behind the results of our mid-range versus superbike video. It has, I think, been difficult to quantify the differences between these two bikes. We do keep coming back to that whole topic of feel. So what I think would be absolutely fascinating next is to see if we can concoct some kind of blind test whereby the challenge is to try and pick out superbike performance without knowing what you're actually riding. Watch this space, we'll see if we can do it. Now, in the meantime, if you fancy a little bit more nerdiness, why not check out our video about the tire pressure? That is another Geek edition. But until then, geek out.